Hello everyone, so let us continue with the discussion about discriminant analysis. So in the previous lecture we saw how the discriminant analysis works for J populations. Therein we did not assume any particular probability model for the populations. Now in today's lecture let us consider multivariate normal model for the probabilities, for the populations. So suppose there are two normal populations of the same dimension, that is p variate, but different mean vectors and same variance covariance matrix. So the first population has mean vector mu 1 and the second one has mean vector mu 2, and the variance covariance matrix is same, that is sigma. So the difference in the two population is just of the mean vector. Please note this. Now assume that these three parameters are known, that is mu 1, mu 2 and sigma are known. Now suppose that we have to classify a new vector x as either coming from the first population or coming from the second population. Now following the philosophy of Neyman-Pearson lemma or likelihood ratio test, we can create the rule for classifying these observations. So we assign the observation x to p variate normal population with mean vector mu 1 and variance covariance matrix sigma if the normal PDF at the vector x for the first population is larger than k times the multivariate normal PDF for the same vector x with mean vector mu 2 and variance covariance matrix sigma. So if we decide this to be a rule, then let us try to simplify this. So this will mean that the ratio of the density function should be greater than k. So let us substitute the PDFs. So the constant part will get cancelled and we can equivalently say that this will be like the ratio of these two exponents should be greater than another constant. We denote that another constant by the letter c. So in the numerator, we'll have e raised to minus half x minus mu 1 transpose sigma inverse x minus mu 1. Whereas in the denominator, we will have instead of mu 1, mu 2. So again, if we take the exponent simplify, so this will be plus half times this term to the numerator. And then if we take the log on both sides, so we'll have minus half times x minus mu 1 transpose sigma inverse x minus mu 1 plus half times x minus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse x minus mu 2. So this this will be log of this constant, but I have used the same notation. So again a constant, so we are using the notation as c. So this again half half. Now let us try to simplify this further. Now we can rewrite this as x prime sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 minus half times mu 1 transpose sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse mu 2. Now how do we get this? So let us expand this. So what do we get? X prime sigma inverse x minus half times x prime sigma inverse x and plus half times x prime sigma inverse x. So that will get cancelled. Then now the other term, that will be minus half times minus mu 1 transpose sigma inverse x. So minus minus will be plus. And so we will have plus half times mu 1 transpose sigma inverse x. And here also similar term will have. So thus this is what we do. We will expand this quadratic form as well as this quadratic form. So some cancellations will happen and some term we can rearrange. And so the rearrangement goes like this. So it looks like this. So we'll have x prime sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2. Notice that this minus half also we have taken to this side. But the notation that we are using for the constant is the same, that is c. Or one can do that, you can start with k, then you can start call this as c1, then this will be c2, then this will be c3, and ultimately whatever constant you get, you denote it by letter c. But basically it will be just a constant. So x prime sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2, so how do we get this? So the x prime sigma inverse mu 1 you will have here, and here you will have x prime sigma inverse mu 2. So because of the opposite signs, this minus term is appearing here. Now similarly, the quantities which do not involve x have been put together and they are like this here. So we get the final simplification of this above term like this, and then we get this to be equivalent to, now this mu 1 prime sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 prime sigma inverse mu 2 can be again rearranged as minus half times mu 1 plus mu 2 transpose, this should be transpose sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2. So the same, this instead of writing these two terms, we are writing it as a quadratic form. But instead of mu 1 prime and mu 2 prime, we are having mu 1 plus mu 2 transpose mu 1 minus mu 2. So again, this is just a simplification of the above term. Now, let ux is sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose x minus half times mu 1 plus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2. So all this left hand side, we are calling it as ux. So now, our discrimination rule was that the first PDF should be greater than k times the second PDF. That is getting simplified as some function of x minus these constants greater than another constant. So this left hand side we are denoting by the letter ux, and now only the first component in ux is function of x, and thus a classification rule can be based on the first term only because this is a constant. Note that mu 1, mu 2 and sigma are known. So ultimately this term will be just a constant which can be always adjusted on the right hand side's constant. And so when it comes to formation of a rule, we should only take into account those terms which involve the variable or a value which is to be classified. So here we are denoting that value as x, and so we take into account only those terms which are functions of x. So the term is this first term, sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose the vector which need into the vector which needs to be classified. So this vector sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 we call as delta. So delta prime x, this will be the term or the part of ux which can be used for creating the classification. Notice that this delta prime x is this x will be the observation that we are going to classify. So this delta prime x is known as Fisher discriminant function or Fisher's discriminant function. Now let us see how this delta prime x is utilized to create the further classifications. So misclassification errors now and their probabilities. So let us see how Fisher's discriminant function can be used to calculate the misclassification errors. So to calculate the misclassification error or misclassification probability, we will need the expectation of ux. So note that this classification is going to be based on delta prime x or ux. And so we would like to know how much is the expectation of ux. So we consider the expectation with respect to the first population. That is, we are assuming that actually x is coming from the first population. And now we are using this function ux to classify this observation. So then what would be the expected value of this ux? So this ux will be sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose x minus this constant. So now when you take expectation with respect to expectation of this term, only this x is a random vector and we are assuming its distribution to be normal p mu 1 sigma. And so this term sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose, this will be just a constant vector. So it can be brought outside the expectation and its transpose is to be taken. So it will be mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse. Now expectation of x, this expectation we can take inside. So expectation of x, assuming that the first population is true population, then it will be simply mu 1. So the expectation of this term delta prime x will be simply mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse mu 1. And now this constant will remain as it is. So now we simplify it further like this. And so we get this as mu 1 minus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 2 into half. So this half we will keep it aside. And this term is nothing but a quadratic form in mu 1 minus mu 2, and this will be the matrix of the sigma inverse will be the matrix of the quadratic form. So common notation for this term is delta, capital delta square p, because it is going to depend on the dimension of the vectors mu1, mu2 and sigma. So here mu1, mu2 is a p-dimensional vector and sigma is a p by p matrix. So we are using the notation delta square p. So this delta square p is like this. So expectation of ux is nothing but half times delta square p. Similarly, we can show that variance of ux is delta square p. So thus, we can see that ux is a linear function of x which has multivariate normal distribution under both the models. And when x follows normal p mu 1 sigma, ux follows normal distribution with mean half times delta square p and variance as delta square p. So why do we say this? So notice that when you have x following normal distribution, then L prime x also follows normal distribution. So following this result, this expectation of ux, following that result and noticing that ux is simply delta prime x minus constants, we can claim that ux also follows normal distribution. And so to know the mean vector and variance covariance matrix, we have calculated them like this. So now what is to be done with this delta x and all? So delta prime x and all. So this delta prime x, notice that this delta prime, this delta square p is a function of mu1 and mu2. And it is actually trying to measure the distance between the two mean vectors by taking into account how much variation is there in the data from where these mu1, mu2 are coming. So both the populations have the same variance covariance matrix, that is sigma. So this Mahalanobis, this distance function or delta square p is based on the inverse of the variance covariance matrix and the difference between the two mean vectors. So this distance function is called as Mahalanobis distance function between two multivariate normal populations, that is normal p mu1 sigma and normal p mu2 sigma. So larger the difference between the vectors, larger will be this value. If mu1 and mu2 differ significantly, then this vector, each element in this vector mu1 minus mu2 will have large value. And so as a result, this delta square p also will exhibit higher values. So now let us consider the probabilities of misclassification. So probability that x gets assigned to second population when it actually came from the first population. So this will mean probability that ux is less than or equal to c. Notice that our discrimination rule was we assign x to the first population if this quantity ux is greater than c. So to compute the misclassification probability, we are going to assume that the observation is coming from the first population. So the true population is p-variate normal with mean vector mu1 and variance covariance matrix sigma. But we are classifying it as an observation coming from the second. So ux should be less than or equal to c then. So we consider the misclassification probability like this. And so this becomes ux less than or equal to c can be equivalently written as z less than or equal to c minus half delta square p upon delta p. Now notice that half delta square p will be the mean and delta square p will be the variance. Notice that this ux will be a real random variable. I have forgotten to mention it anywhere, but note that ux will not be a random vector, but it will be a random variable because its dimension will be simply 1 cross 1. Simply 1 cross 1. And so this expectation, this half delta square p is also 1 cross 1 and this variance is also 1 cross 1. So this z, this c minus, this ux minus half delta square p upon delta p is just the standardized version of ux, which will again follow standard normal distribution. And so this probability will be, can be computed from the standard normal CDF. Now similarly, probability, another misclassification probability, that is probability of assigning x to the first population when it came from the second population, will be like this. So now these are also called as misclassification errors. So the two misclassification errors are equally serious. So we must obtain C such that these two probabilities are equal. So the probabilities will be equal if these two constants match. So these two constants match when C is equal to 0. So we take C equal to 0. And so we get a simplified version of the rule, discriminant rule based on Fisher's principle. And that is, it will, if ux is greater than 0, then we assign the observation to the first population. Otherwise, we assign the observation to the second population. So this was a simplified case because we were assuming mu1, mu2 and sigma to be known. Now let us see what happens when mu1, mu2 and sigma are unknown. So the sample based classification rule then is obtained by substituting the parameters by their respective maximum likelihood estimators. So see, the trouble is now that mu1, mu2, sigma themselves are unknown. So what we can do is we can replace them by their MLEs. So for mu1, the MLE will be the sample mean vector for the first population. For mu2, the MLE will be the sample mean vector for the second population. And for sigma, the MLE would be the pulled estimate of sigma, like this, where S1 plus S2 upon N1 plus N2. Here we are assuming that the sample coming from the first population is of size N1 and that coming from the second population is of size N2. So S1 plus S2. So S1 will be simply summation xi minus x bar into xi minus x bar transpose. Similarly, S2 will be, sorry, xi minus x bar into xi minus x bar transpose. Similarly, S2 will be summation yi minus y bar into yi minus y bar transpose. So now the classification rule is, so this, since this is an estimate of ux obtained by replacing the parameters by their MLEs, so the notation is u curl x. So the classification rule is that if u curl x is greater than 0, then we assign the observation to the first population, otherwise we assign it to the second population. Now note that this u curl x, again only first term in the u curl x involves the observation x, the other terms are just constants. And so this first term, let us consider this first term, we call this as this matrix sigma hat inverse x bar minus y bar, we call it as d prime. Then this will be d prime x, and because this is based on sample, because we are not knowing mu1, mu2 and sigma, instead we are using their MLEs. So this is called as Fisher's sample discriminant function. And so the total u curl x then can be rearranged, and then we can rewrite the way we wrote Mahalanobis distance function. In the same manner, we can rewrite this Mahalanobis sample discriminant function like this. So let us see quickly now an observation, sorry, an example. So suppose we have a sample of size 3 from a bivariate population. So the first sample from the first population, the sample coming from the first population is this. 3, 7 is the first observation, 2, 4 is the second, 4, 7 is the third. So this is a random sample coming from bivariate normal distribution with mean vector mu1 and variance covariance matrix sigma. Similarly, this is the sample coming from the second population with mean mu2 and variance covariance matrix sigma. Now we are told to classify another new observation, 2, 7, to be either coming from the first or from the second population. So the first thing that we do is, here we notice that mu1, mu2, sigma are unknown. So we need to estimate them. So let us consider the sample mean vector for the first population. So sample mean vector will be simply average of 3, 2, 4 and average of 7, 4, 7. So average of 3, 2, 4 is 3 and average of 7, 4, 7 is 6. And so the first sample mean vector is 3, 6. Similarly, the second sample mean vector is 5, 8. Now we identify, now what we need to do is, we need to identify the, now we need to find the sigma hat, that is pulled estimate of the variance covariance matrix as defined before, which is S1 plus S2 upon N1 plus N2. So I hope that you will be able to do this using this formulae, and you will be able to classify this observation as either coming from the first or from the second. So let us stop here.